Penguin Random House Audio presents One Mission, How Leaders Build a Team of Teams by Chris Fussell with C.W. Goodyear, with a foreword read by General Stanley McChrystal. This is the author, Chris Fussell. To the men and women on the battlefield and throughout industry who are fighting every day to define the future of leadership.
Forward. We first met in a time of tremendous uncertainty. It was 2004, and our initial expectations of rapid victory in Iraq and Afghanistan had faded into reluctant recognitions that the fight ahead would be long, brutal, and unlike anything we'd seen before. In many ways, we were very different. I was a 50-year-old soldier, just completing my first of what would ultimately be almost 5 years commanding an elite counterterrorist task force. Chris Fussell was a Navy SEAL in this organization and was 20 years younger than me. We crossed paths for only an hour at his small team's outpost along the Afghanistan-Pakistan border, but even in our brief initial encounter, I recognized a reflective nature that struck me. We would meet again less than a year later in Iraq. Chris had moved up in the organization and was serving as an operations officer at one of the three regional headquarters our task force had in the country. In this context, he was responsible for reallocating resources, staying attuned to operations, and sharing intelligence. In such a managerial role, it was natural and almost expected to become ruled by the tyranny of the here and now. Chris was certainly masterful in his conduct of the current fight, but it was his uncommon curiosity about the larger how behind it all that stood out to me. Chris's constant questioning revealed a unique interest in the design and experimentation taking place at the task force's strategic level. For example, he wanted to know how we managed the decentralized decision-making that he and his peers had become accustomed to, how we maintained awareness of, but did not impede, the resourcing decisions taking place at the small unit level, and where I saw the broadest gulfs in information sharing between our organization and outside partners. His queries were informed, but in the context of the overwhelming tasks of the daily fight he was orchestrating, to find the time and willpower even to ask them was notable. Chris was therefore a natural selection to be the aide-de-camp for my final year in command. If he truly wanted to see behind the organization's strategic curtain, a year at my side in Iraq would be a grand opportunity to round out his learning. His primary assigned duty was to manage the logistics of the task force's senior leadership team and ensuring that we were spending our time in accordance with the organization's priorities around the world. In addition, I advised him at the outset to exploit this opportunity, to actively learn how it all actually worked. And that is what he did. For a year, Chris took it all in, observing the nuances of our organization's process and structure with keen interest. He then went on to graduate school, and still not satisfied, wrote a master's thesis on how our task force had organized our intelligence fusion centers around the globe to identify and capture best practices throughout our teams. So perhaps it was inevitable that over time, Chris and I found ourselves connected after the war by a shared fascination, almost a fixation, on the disorienting new phenomenon of complexity that we'd faced on the battlefield and could see across almost every facet of life now that we'd left the service. In the autumn of 2010, 6 years after we'd first met, Chris and I sat at my kitchen table and talked about how and why the special operations community had made such a significant organizational leap in the post-9/11 years. "If this doesn't get captured in a book, history will get it wrong," he said. By it, Chris meant how our task force had adapted to an insurgency in Iraq that was a technologically enabled, interconnected network of highly autonomous individual actors. More akin to mobs or violent gangs than a traditional understanding of insurgency would have led us to believe, its membership was motivated by an extremist ideology to foster unconstrained violence wherever possible. To combat the speed and effectiveness of this type of adversary, we'd shifted, reluctantly, from a masterfully constructed, purpose-built, centralized structure to a decentralized but deeply connected entity whose distributed teams could move with the fluidity of a network while retaining the focus and stability of a bureaucracy. At the time of that conversation, I was just beginning to write my memoirs, which would consume my efforts for the next 2 years. But underlying that biographical work was an alternate story, the one that I most wanted to tell. And in the spring of 2013, we told it via the writing project that Chris had first suggested, Team of Teams, New Rules of Engagement for a Complex World, which would be released in the spring of 2015, reflecting years of thought and extensive research on the topic we'd first considered at my bland kitchen table. Team of Teams met our intent to lay out a case about environmental change in modern competitive realms and deeply resonated with leaders across a wide spectrum of organizations. The consistent, "you describe my organization's problem" type of feedback we received reinforced our conclusions that the challenge the task force had encountered was not unique to combat, but a universal one that reflected the common conditions of our era. The hierarchical organizational models and leadership norms that we all grew up in were designed for a different type of environment than what we were now all facing. Organizations must adapt to the realities of the information age or face existential risk. Our Team of Teams approach, with its emphasis on shared consciousness and empowered execution, was an important framing and gave language to this universal threat. Though we didn't call it such at the time of the Iraq War, a Team of Teams is an operating framework for an organization that we've seen work on the battlefield and in industry. It is grounded in the creation of true strategic alignment across an organization, executing disciplined, broad, and transparent communications, and decentralizing decision-making to the edge of the enterprise. It allows traditional organizations to retain the strength of their bureaucracy while moving with the speed of a network. But Team of Teams did not address a possibly more important follow-up question: how exactly do you create an adaptable organization? When we realized that there was a clear need for a book to address the specific practices and behaviors that made our transition possible, I immediately thought that the right person to take on this project was Chris. Chris had been more acutely focused on the how of our organizational transformation than anyone else I knew. Sure, other officers might have led at higher levels, had more intense battlefield stories, or saw parts of the war that Chris did not. But in my many years within the special operations community, I didn't know a single leader who was more intellectually curious as to what was practically taking place at an organization-wide level across all tiers and different perspectives that our hierarchy offered. Of equal importance, Chris will offer a view on what behaviors a Team of Teams model requires from its leaders if it is to truly thrive. In the task force, we had not only to create a new series of practices, but also to leverage that model through the communalization of new cultural norms and behaviors. As senior leaders, it was obvious to us that the various parts of the organization were, in the early days of the fight, both unable and unwilling to connect and share as a truly unified team. We could redesign ourselves and create not only the capability to connect, but the willingness to create a new culture, one populated by exceptionally powerful tribes. Without both aspects in place, the effort to establish either one is redundant. This audiobook offers, in my opinion, a critical response to one of the most difficult questions that the world is currently wrestling with: how must our models for leading and managing large systems evolve? Chris and his co-author, Charlie Goodyear, a brilliant young Yale graduate, mapped the course toward a hybrid structure that is, more through disciplined trial and error than through academic forethought, what we eventually created within the task force. I believe that organizations hoping to survive in today's increasingly complex world will need to, as we did on the battlefield, retain the strength and stability of a hierarchy while simultaneously adopting the speed and decentralization of a network, as well as the behaviors necessary for them to function. If you're a leader looking to build your own Team of Teams, Chris and Charlie offer you a roadmap. General Stanley McChrystal retired March 2017.
Introduction. In 2014, I was invited to join my former commanding officer, Stan McChrystal, as a co-author in writing Team of Teams. Our goal in writing it was to offer our view on why the military models of the 20th century were fundamentally misaligned with the realities of an information age battlefield. The speed and interconnectivity of this new type of conflict forced the senior leadership within our branch of the special operations community to make a choice: lead us through a culture change or potentially lose the fight against Al-Qaeda. They chose the former. Team of Teams explored a simple idea that sat at the epicenter of the challenge in making this culture change. How can large organizations move with the speed and agility of a small team? In that vein, our writing team laid out the reactive small team dynamics that are so powerfully highlighted within the special operations units, as well as in any number of other high-performing teams. We explained that a small team's ability to quickly adapt comes from the combination of four key drivers. First, their members trust one another. Second, they are bound by a sense of common purpose, a shared ideology or purposeful trait. Third, given the size and rich interconnectivity of a small team, they can create a sense of shared consciousness amongst the group, a state in which all members have a common understanding of their mutually held problem set, shared access to key information, and are aligned in the direction they need to move next. You felt this, most likely, in small teams you've been on, but recreating this state at scale and with necessary regularity is a far greater challenge. With these three initial factors in place, the fourth and final quality can exist: empowered execution. The ultimate goal in today's quickly changing environment for an organization is the ability to decentralize decision-making rights down to those actors closest to the issues. Empowered execution was, for the special operations community, the key to moving as fast or faster than the rate of change in our external environment. Empowered execution creates the space for teams to act with autonomy, but as it is coupled with the influence of shared consciousness, it is high accountability, and therefore risk-reduced autonomy. The book we wrote found an audience with senior leaders across many industries. From the reading list of the Commandant of the Marine Corps to Walmart's CEO Doug McMillan's 2016 list of must-reads, the book's ideas found receptive audiences in some of the world's most seasoned and credentialed leaders. Even with Team of Teams as a frame, however, readers have continued to ask us a common series of questions. I accept the premise, but how exactly do we implement this model? Or, what are the most important steps to focus on when attempting a Team of Teams? Or even, how does a forum with thousands of people not devolve into total chaos? To this day, I'll also often get another line of questioning, meant to be respectful of our team's efforts in conflict, but which expresses a healthy skepticism about whether lessons from a modern battlefield can truly apply to other realms. What your organization did was impressive, but it's different here. In the military, you can just give orders, and subordinates have to follow. It's not like that in the civilian world. If there are any former military folks in the room, they will invariably chuckle at this. I was on active duty for just over 15 years, and I can't think of a single time that I ever truly gave or received an order like the one you might imagine from watching a war movie, in which a higher-ranking officer's harsh words are universally adhered to and respected by those under their command. That approach doesn't work well in the conventional military, and it falls even further short in the special operations community, where triple-selected, highly qualified, and deeply experienced personalities don't take kindly to being ordered by an officer with less practical experience than they possess. Regardless of context, a leader cannot simply command people what to do and expect them to wholeheartedly follow. Rather, their task should be to guide teams, influence their decision-making, and give them appropriate but not overly restrictive guardrails. But guardrails like this are impossible to establish without one critical factor: an organizational model that retains stability where necessary while also allowing for the distributed decision-making that is mandated by our information age. Many of the questions I've received, of course, can be compounded into the following line. What are the practical and tangible steps that business leaders must take if they are to build their own team of teams? Team of Teams told our story and made an argument about the final state that modern organizations need to arrive at to succeed, but it was not a practicum on how to reach that goal. Our intent herein is to offer just that, to provide leaders with a sense of the necessary steps to creating a team of teams. Having spent several years both experiencing and observing as this change took hold in its original context, I had the good fortune to be exposed to the inner workings of this model. As a tactical level junior leader in our organization, I was positioned to feel the impact that these practices were having on the organization. As an operational level leader, I was responsible for helping implement these changes. But most interestingly, as McChrystal's aide-de-camp during his final year commanding our task force, I had a front-row seat to how these practices were working from a strategic perspective. Such a chief of staff type role is becoming more in demand in private sector organizations.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.